And now for the sponsor perspective portion of the program. A quick note before we get underway. While I'm asking these questions, and they're really mine, this portion of the program shouldn't be considered editorial in nature. With that, I'm joined by Brian Hedricks. He's Vice President of Policy and Public Affairs at Nokia Americas. Brian, you know, I find this kind of a unique moment where all this money, I've sort of been an advocate for infrastructure spending from many presidents and president terms. I sort of feel, okay, now we're here. How do we get it right? And I want to ask you to do our viewers a favor. Is I want you to imagine that this is before Wilbur and Orville Wright flew the plane. And, you know, life changed after that. Like, we're at an inflection point. I want you to paint a picture for our audience and tell a picture graphically of what this world that we're going into next might look like. How can infrastructure be different, bolder, better in ways? Paint that picture for us.
Well, sure. Thanks, first of all, Steve, for having us and for the another highly successful event here from the Hill. I guess I would say, picking up on Administrator Fernandez's comments right at the tail end there, really important that we recognize this is a seminal moment in time where we're not going to get another great big chance like this to do a massive infrastructure push in the United States. And we would be really stepping on the rake if we just replaced like for like and didn't anticipate some of the connectivity needs for smart transportation, precision agriculture, intelligent manufacturing, those kinds of things that are going to increase productivity and ultimately lead to a much more sustainable society going forward. And at the core of all of that is the power of networks to transform how we do things. We've had several events with the Hill talking about this very topic, but at the core of all of that is networks and connectivity and reach and getting to everyone. But you can imagine a future which is highly networked, highly adaptable, programmable, with greater productivity and less environmental impact for that more sustainable, more equity-based society.
I mean, I hear in what you said, I want to just highlight it for a moment, because, you know, as we come through and we think a lot about sustainability, we do a ton of sustainability programs. We talk about the climate, we talk about water. But when you have sensors embedded in everything, you're measuring everything, you've got data feeds. Guess what, folks? You get to conserve. You get to be smarter about resource allocation. And I'm just wondering whether we've done a good enough job of looking at that element of data as a part of our profile and how we respond to climate or violent weather or some of the things that we've been seeing that are hitting not only this country but globally, that part of the answer is not just new bridges and roads, part of the answer is sensors and data.
Exactly. And the short answer is no, we haven't done a good enough job in the past, but we're getting better at it. And the power of big data, data science in the last 10 years has grown exponentially, like computing power, quite frankly. And the ability of data analytics to lead to far more predictiveness and maintenance, not having something as basic as not having to roll a truck anymore so that two guys with a wrench can bang on a pipe and find out where you have a problem in your sewer distribution or your water distribution system, but to have network capability to pinpoint where you have an actual need to predict the maintenance needs for all of your critical infrastructure before you actually have problems. All of those things rely on significant amounts of data and processing power and capability. And those are becoming a massive underpinning in the conversations that we're having with policymakers. So that's very encouraging. The one thing to keep in mind for all the administrators who will be sending this funding out is, particularly in areas like transit or in ports and airports, we really should not be funding and building infrastructure that simply swaps out like for like. Not only should we be looking for the latest technologies, we need to ensure that if we're building a new road or bridge, an overpass, we're putting attachment points for future wireless infrastructure so that we can anticipate and seed for growth opportunities moving forward as we push the technology deeper and deeper into our physical infrastructure.
So your message is do not replace like for like. That's a very important focus. Don't be incremental. I mean, that's what I mean. Incremental is even maybe a little bit of step, but I'm just wondering, you know, you get very few opportunities in life to make strategic leaps, to rewire and correct mistakes, you know, to be different. And I'm just interested in What would be, you know, we all need to think about what would be the biggest mistakes we could make? What would be the biggest screw-ups that you, given your experience and knowledge of the United States government, what can we do to get in way of the vision that we deserve as American taxpayers and citizens?
Well, we've already talked about it, and that is, if as a rule of thumb, if your grandparents would recognize the deployment plans that our administrators come up with for the funding, then we will have made a massive mistake. We have an opportunity to really, it's not smart just in terms of intelligence, it's smart in terms of the capability sets for the infrastructure that we're going to deploy. And some of it is common sense, Steve. If you're going to drop new miles of highway, you know, pull through a conduit so that future, when you want to put fiber in place, you don't have to tear up the roadway to do it again. Some of those kinds of incredibly intelligent processes, building in sensors into technology for monitoring, the use of AI and machine learning, both from a security perspective to protect our critical infrastructure, to detect and adapt to attacks, but also just for physical maintenance purposes. And imagine today, in most municipalities, you've got water storage facilities. I like this example because it's pretty basic for everybody to understand. You drive past these huge water towers that are full of water, and they're engineered for like the peak capacity usage of a town. But you can't leave the water sitting in them indeterminately because it spoils. So after some period of time, you've got to flush all that water out and refill it. And you waste an enormous amount of those resources. But with the power of networks and intelligence, you will have the predictiveness to be able to determine how to engineer, you know, for peak usage and not waste water, and have ways to draw additional water sources into the system if you need to, in an automated way. So if we don't do that, if we just simply replace the infrastructure with the kinds of things that we've had in the past, that is a massively wasted opportunity to gain productivity, efficiency. And again, we all have this vision of sustainability. It's not just building greener products that consume less power. It's about the ways in which the technology itself can transform entire sectors of the economy. And if we are not prudent, if we rush to just push the money out the door in order to spend it because we have it, and we aren't thoughtful enough, then we will look back at this as a missed opportunity. And I will say this. You've been talking about infrastructure policy for multiple presidents, and frankly, so have a lot of other people, myself included. It doesn't happen very often. It's been infrastructure week in Washington for at least 6 years. If they finally put the ball in the hole, and it's not right to view this as a down payment. I don't wish to be a pessimist about this, but the likelihood that this Congress and this type of situation is going to come through with another $1 trillion package sometime down the road is, well, I would just say that's not a very strong likelihood. So we have to treat this as a last best chance. Be prudent, be thoughtful, be creative, use all the technologies that are available to you. And at the end of the day, again, if your grandparents would recognize what we're doing, we've done something wrong.
I want to read for our audience. I laughed out loud reading one of your tweets. I want to tell everybody, you know, Brian Hendricks can be followed on Twitter at BMHend, H-E-N-D, 54. That's his great thing. But I laughed out loud at this, where you say, infrastructure week, legislating auditing Congress is now like Hotel California, where you can check out, but nothing can ever leave. If Congress can't do this with the criticality of the needs, we should fold the circus tent and let trained SEALs legislate. Pretty tough words on disappointment in the past. And I hear your enthusiasm for it, but one of the areas we haven't discussed much in this program or other programs, but I found in your Twitter feed, is about aviation. And I started with the Wilburn Overwright reference on purpose. It was inspired by your tweets of sort of say, hey, you know, we all think about airplanes and air traffic control and data as probably being smart. But I get the sense that you're saying this is one of the key areas where we are behind, where we have not taken advantage of the new infrastructure investment that may be coming on, looking at how that interacts with, you know, taking an adequate system and improving it, dealing with spectrum realities. I'd just love to get because you and I have never talked about this, I'd love to get a snapshot of where we're screwing up on aviation that we need to fix as we think about this new refit of infrastructure in the country.
Yeah, it's not just aviation. I would add ports and rail into that as well. But And let's just focus on ports and airports for a moment. Two areas that received substantial treatment in the infrastructure law, I think between them, there's something like $40 billion available. There's nothing specifically in the language of the law that allows for digital infrastructure as part of that. Doesn't preclude it either. But there are things called out like, you know, dredging ports to make them deeper. Well, that's certainly understandable. Replacing antiquated air traffic control systems, that's understandable too. But just as an example, in the port context, Nokia, I think, has deployed so far at least six private network solutions with port terminal operators in the United States. They have found that these systems are greatly superior to Wi-Fi because of the throughput and the lack of latency, which allows you to do things like real-time security cameras on top of the network, sorts of things that, you know, for very small investment dollars, you can make a substantial impact right now in cargo clearing and backlogs that are existing at the ports. Same with airports, where Wi-Fi systems are perfectly reasonable, but they're limited. They're shared. Right. They have limited throughput. There's an opportunity here by setting aside, and we're not talking about, you know, the bulk of the $40 billion between the two. You're talking about a few hundred million dollars. You could really make a dramatic impact in allowing the deployment of these high bandwidth, low latency networks that will greatly improve the outcomes, the productivity, the security of our resources. So part of this discussion is to make sure that it isn't precluded by the law. Let's make sure we actually include the idea of digital infrastructure in the ports and the airports and the rail and in the other surface transportation areas, because for small money, you can get massive, massive improvements in your capability.
Hey, Brian, we just went through almost an entire conversation together without mentioning either one of us 5G, I think. And so that's fascinating because, you know, you're the 5G players for America. And I just love, as we close this out, to hear from you. Where is America now on 5G? What are you confident about? What are you worried about?
So the United States is in a good position globally, I think, relative to the markets that everybody looks at as the leaders in 5G. It's the United States, it's China, it's Korea, it's Japan. Hmm. And the U.S. is right there. We're in the front of the pack in terms of the coverage and the capability that is out there now. Areas of concern, obviously, supply chain. I think we've had other shows talking about semiconductor shortage issues and how that will actually limit our ability to deploy as broadly and as quickly as we would like. I think we haven't done a good enough job, candidly, of supporting the enterprise use case in America. So think about incentives for manufacturing, agriculture, healthcare, education to adopt mobile broadband as a significant force multiplier and productivity multiplier. And that's going to be a really important part of the business case for 6G. Spectrum is extremely expensive in the United States, more so than any other market. And it's really going to be important for the large carriers to be able to point at the fact that you don't have just individual subscribers. You've now got enterprises adopting the capability on a wide scale. It sets up a very strong business case for 6G, which will go to the next level. But I would say overall, the U.S. is in really good shape. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of policies that we could change, focusing on enterprise and addressing some of those issues that I think will continue to put the U.S. in a very strong position.
Well, listen, I always love my conversation with Brian Hendricks, and, you know, we're going to do it here. We ought to have a podcast together or something, but, you know, I tell my audience that, you know, Nokia owns Bell Labs. Bell Labs, one of the most important centers of innovation in the United States ever, and we should get you up there one time and just kind of walk through and kind of show us all this super secret stuff that you're developing and what the future is going to look like. But Brian Hendricks, Vice President of Policy and Public Affairs at Nokia, thank you so much.
Thanks, Steve.
We'll be right back.